Hi, and welcome to Downtown Alive. My name is Jack Molets, and I'm your host for the program. And we're basically a program about downtown Reading, and specifically the Downtown Improvement District. And if you don't know about the Downtown Improvement District, otherwise known as DID, and what it is, it's an organization that is focused on creating a vital, productive, and commercially active environment in downtown Reading. DID provides cleaning, security, and marketing services for a specially designated commercial district in the city, and also sponsors several events and activities throughout the year. And those include the Midday Cafe, the Reading Holiday Parade, and the Reading Fire and Ice Fest. DID continually strives to make downtown Reading a cleaner, safer, and more inviting place to live, work, and visit. And you can learn more about DID on our website at www.downtownreading.com. And with that, we're going to get into today's show. And we have two guests here. Allow me to introduce to you Shane Hillard, who is Ambassador's Manager.
Correct.
And with him is Chris Vazquez, who is Night Shift Supervisor of the Ambassadors. Just a quick question for anybody who doesn't know, who are the Ambassadors? What is it you folks do? I know you wear red shirts, and they look lovely, by the way. But I just wondered, if someone doesn't know, what do Ambassadors do?
Right, we're basically representatives of the Downtown Improvement District. As ambassadors, we're responsible for a number of things. We are out there greeting the public, providing information to them. Maybe they need some information on a particular restaurant downtown. We'll give them information on the restaurant. We're out there being eyes and ears of the police department. If we see anything of an illegal nature, we'll, from a safe distance, report that to the police so they can come out and deal with the situation. We do a number of kind of minor landscaping tasks in the spring, summer, pulling weeds, spraying for weeds, litter control, mm-hmm. Weed abatement. In the winter, obviously, we're out there shoveling snow. We've got plows on our vehicles, so we're plowing snow. We lay salt out at the crosswalks and the intersections. Number of different things. We provide escorts when people call us if they want a presence to and from their workspace to their vehicle. We'll be more than happy to go out there and meet them and walk them to and from wherever they need to go.
So, and I'm sure, and you're there in the evening.
Yes.
When there are services, I suspect mm-hmm. some people, especially, mm-hmm. would like to have them,
definitely.
Come over. Walk me to my car, especially.
Especially in the evening when there's a lot of events. The Santander Arena, Santander Performing Arts. You got the concerts, you got the games, I get the phone calls. Just people feel more comfortable when they have someone walking with them.
Oh, so. Sure.
Especially when it's 9:30, 10 o'clock at night.
Yeah, I do. a couple of things we're going to discuss. And the first one is the 2016 Fire and Ice Fest. It took place in January 15th and 16th,
correct.
To be exact, the week before the huge snowstorm, mm-hmm. thankfully. And it was a great success. It was exciting. It was fun. I was there. I thought, it was just great to see all the people out and in the square and mm-hmm. doing various things. And by the way, for anybody who wasn't there and wants to make sure they get there next year, or for anybody who was there and wants to doubly make sure they get there next year, it will be January 13th and 14th, 2017. But first, let's talk about the one in 2016. A couple of things went on. There were bands playing on Penn Square at 6th and Penn. There was some fire demonstrations. And there were also some other special things. Later in the night, there was the Snowfall Ball at the DoubleTree, DoubleTree Hotel downtown, and we have a picture here of the Uptown Band that was playing at the DoubleTree, and they looked great and they had a great time. Now, they were protected from the cold. It wasn't super cold, but
it
was nice for January. It was beautiful, what I thought was funny was, it rained, mm-hmm. started raining later Friday evening, mm-hmm. just about the time it was over.
Yes.
And it cleared up in time for the start on Saturday morning. Exactly. It was lovely. If it was going to rain, that was the perfect timing. One of the other things that went on, this was at the, I want to say...
Like the chili?
That's the chili cook-off at the Abraham Lincoln. Although they don't call it that these days, do they? Cook-off, they still call it the Abraham Lincoln Hotel, I guess, but I thought of another name, too. Well, I know it as that. So, but that was the chili cook-off, and that took place... I guess Saturday midday, and that was very popular with different people trying the different chilies. Now, did you gentlemen didn't get a chance to go there, or did you?
No, during the events itself, we're busy with our duties.
Right. So we didn't wear it, putting it on outside.
Yeah. Correct, but I did talk to, I think, one of the judges this year, and they said that they were very impressed with the results. So he was very happy with the quality of the chili. So,
yeah, I talked to some people who tasted chili and they loved every minute of it. Okay, who would not love eating chili?
Right.
That's all I've got to say. As I said, down at 6th and Penn, there were some folks who were playing music. There was music literally all Friday evening. And all day, pretty much all day Saturday, beginning at noon, straight through until 10 o'clock at night. And this was one of the performers, the name of which is escaping me at the moment. But they were there, and they did some singing and carrying on. And here's something else that was going on.
Oh, the ice shaving.
Yeah, during the festival, people were ice sculpting.
Correct.
They were making various shapes and various sizes and various things to look at, and this was just one of them. There were two different parts of that, right?
Mm-hmm.
There was the one was the demonstration.
Demonstration, which is the picture you're seeing there, and then the other was where he actually had pre-sculpted a few, and there were some sponsors for each of the sculptors, and they were placed throughout the block on both sides of the street.
Now, there was some sort of competition, too, one day, too, so for the actual sculpting, which made it kind of interesting.
Large crowd for it.
Very. There were large crowds for everything. I was impressed, a little surprised, because people, you're asking people to come outside. In January, but a lot of crowd. I think everybody had a good time, or they seemed to. There was some more ice sculpting going on. I'm not sure. Are those some kind of?
It looks like a lion.
Fish or?
I think that was a dragon.
Was that the dragon?
Oh, that's the dragon. Yeah. Now I see it. So it's hard for me to identify dragons, but now that was one of them. This is one of them that.
That's a popular one. People take pictures with that a lot.
Yeah. And that was done ahead of time.
Yes.
And it was brought in and put down. It was, as you said, it was one of several in the 500 block of Penn Street. And this was an ice sculptor, and people loved sitting on that and...
Take pictures.
Take a picture of yourself on a throne. That's a throne, basically, or a captain's chair. That's a throne. It's a king's chair or whatever. And
That shows more of the crowd.
That's more of the crowd, big crowd. And that was right there at 5th and Penn Street. And
behind that crowd there, too, is some stands that the city provided for. So there was a couple decks of stands where people were also sitting.
Oh, that's right. You're right. Not on the other side, but on this side.
Yes, right behind, yes.
Probably someone was standing on there when they took this picture.
Correct.
But, which makes it nice because it was a lot easier to see that way. And now even up where the music was, there were some people, and especially during the fire part, they had a little trouble seeing because the music was up on a stage, so that wasn't a problem.
Yes.
The fire was down
lower.
Below.
Correct.
So, it was great. I mean, it was a fantastic day.
There's some of the fire.
And there is the fire. And, I got to admit, I didn't know what to expect when it came to the fire and the demonstrations of fire. Yeah, this person, I guess, is, would you call it swallowing fire or breathing fire?
Breathing fire, right.
And that was cool. And the other parts of it were like they would alight things and twist them around and spin them around and... It was really neat. The first one On Friday night, got a big crowd, and then on Saturday night, there were two more,
two different.
But I think so. I think some of the same people came back too, mm-hmm. because
there were two different fire groups.
Right. One came. The one young lady, as I recall, came from Philadelphia, and the other group came from the Lehigh Valley, Allentown. So that was exciting. I mean, the whole fire and ice thing. This was the second year, we should point out.
Correct.
Now, they tell me, I wasn't there the first year, mm-hmm. but...
I wasn't there the first year either. Okay, this is my first as well.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. But everybody said that it, as far as crowds, I mean, it much popular, much mm-hmm. more popular. Mm-hmm. More people came than ever before. We don't have a picture of it, but one of the things that was super popular was the slide.
Yes, I was going to mention
There was an ice slide.
Yes. A lot of the children love that. So
did you go down?
I was working in that area, so I got to see some of it. But obviously, we're on duty when
so
that's happening.
You can't have fun.
No. I can't have fun. We actually had one of our ambassadors that was posted at the slide as mm-hmm. well. So he got to enjoy the kids having fun. But again, that's another opportunity for the photos. And it was a long line. Every time I walked past, I saw a long line.
Like a 40-person line.
Yeah. I noticed. They were just people. My understanding was popular last year too, and mm-hmm. popular again this year. Mm-hmm. I suspect that'll come back again next year.
I'm sure. Yeah, I wouldn't doubt it.
Why not? Mm-hmm. But that was the Fire and Ice Festival, and it was just a spectacular time in downtown Reading. It was just one of the things that these folks do. But I earlier I referenced the fact that. I do want to point out that if you want to see more photos. There are more photos on the website. Again, the website being www.downtownreading.com.
Well, for the Fire and Ice.
Oh, and there's another Fire and Ice Fest.
Specific one for Fire and Ice.
Oh, okay.
You have the readingfireandicefest.com.
Great. So there you go. And there's probably links to it from the main site, too.
Correct, yes.
And just again, a reminder that January 13th and 14th, 2017
yes.
will be the next one, so mark your calendars right now, okay? Now, one of the things I referenced was, I said at the beginning, that when we started talking about fire and ice, I said, it's good it wasn't the following weekend, mm-hmm. because the following weekend was that Saturday that we all remember
yes.
so well.
Yes.
When, what we got, 30 inches of snow?
At least, historic.
I'm sure you guys, it must have seemed like about 60.
Right? Correct. Yeah, you're right.
And one of your jobs was, of course, to get rid of it.
Absolutely.
Out of, I say Penn Square, but it's more than Penn Square.
Penn Street, and it's roughly in the downtown area, roughly about 40 square blocks.
40 square blocks.
Yeah.
How do you get rid of snow mm-hmm. from 40 square blocks?
Sure. We have a lot of equipment that we use for that. We have a truck that also has a plow on it. We have a little four-wheeler that has a plow on it. We've got a couple of snow blowers, which we used extensively, and we, of course, were shoveling the snow. We have some metal brushes that spin the snow out of our mm-hmm. way.
Oh.
So we've got a number of different pieces of equipment that we use to get the snow out of the way as soon as possible.
Great. Well, we have some photos here of the snow in downtown Reading, and I'm sure, well, first of all, I guess we're all sick and tired of seeing snow. But that was quite, now this one was after the some cleanup took place,
yeah,
obviously, because
yes.
you can see the brick, and I'm sure at some mm-hmm. point on Saturday mm-hmm. you couldn't.
No, you're right.
I couldn't see much of anything as,
right.
as I recall.
It started snowing on Saturday, and it continued all the way through Sunday morning. And so what our plan was Saturday we have a regular shift on duty anyway, so and Chris was part of that shift. And we brought a few extra people in on overtime to kind of keep ahead of the snow as much as we could
yeah.
throughout Saturday so that we didn't get a very large accumulation that we'd have to deal with on Sunday. So we tried to maintain it on Saturday as much as we could. And then on Sunday it was a bit more manageable, and we stayed till about 9 o'clock at night Sunday. Finishing up everything. So
that was a hard one to get in front of.
It was a big one.
This, of course, 6th and Penn Street.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Looking toward the CVS, and We also have...
That's in front of one of our buildings. I think that's 645 Penn Street.
Okay. Right, right. And that's... So what you do there is, and this is a good thing, what you do there is make the open walkway underneath, and so that you don't have to worry about the sidewalk outside, and that way people can walk that way, and it's probably a lot safer.
Yeah, that's actually looking towards going inside to our courtyard area, and in the courtyard area is the entrance to our garage. So there's an elevator there. So we wanted to make sure that there was a pathway for people when they're parking to come from the parking garage into their workspaces.
And there's just another area that's
a crosswalk.
Right.
Right.
And that takes you over to the south side of Penn Street in the 600 block. See, I know my...
you do, you're very good.
And that's along the railroad tracks on the west side of the railroad tracks. Again, if access from Penn Street back to the parking garage.
Yes.
Not to drive back, but to walk back.
To walk back, yes.
Okay. And, oh.
There's a few of us there.
There's some guys working.
Right.
Having a good time.
Actually, we did have a good time.
did you?
We did. We had fun with it. We worked long hours. It was a 12, 14-hour day each day, but I bought them lunch. We went over to Subway and just had a good time. That's two of us, one shoveling and one is actually using our snowblower in the background, and that's a crosswalk that we're clearing out.
Right. Subway, even supporting one of the downtown businesses.
Absolutely. I'm a big supporter of Subway.
And we have just another shot.
Another shot.
Same place. Mm-hmm. And let's see.
That's a separate crosswalk.
This is where the photographer didn't want to go plowing through some snow. They also.
So just after he
removes that snow with the snowblower, the shoveler will come by and clear up the rest of that excess snow, and then we'll throw the salt out.
Right. And, fortunately, one of the good things is that the temperature wasn't bad.
It wasn't bad.
So especially for melting purposes, once you got the salt down, you're in pretty good shape. So.
That's an evening shot. That one probably was about 8:30 one of those nights, probably Sunday.
That was Saturday.
I'm going to say it's probably Saturday. Yeah, it looks like up in there.
An amateur took that picture. That was me. You can see my. We didn't crop that out.
Oh, your thumbprint.
Yeah, right. Well, that was a great picture. Otherwise,
outside of that. people complain.
Yeah.
I like you have a very nice finger, bud.
I appreciate that. Yeah.
I do what I can. And there we are.
That's a little before shot.
That's Saturday.
That was,
but you can see that that's a big job. That's just looking at that. That's just one place.
Mm-hmm.
And look at the work you have to do and the job you have to do.
Right.
So, I guess what we can say is that. Mm-hmm. You guys, the ambassadors, and the whole downtown improvement district, the necessity to have somebody down there to clear it out so it's ready to go when people want to come downtown, or they have to go to a business, or they have to go to a restaurant, or whatever.
Right.
Everything is. So this is it just shows the need and the necessity for a special force there.
Yeah, that was our goal, was to make sure that we cleared out as much as we could so that the businesses could have a regular day of operation come Monday morning, and I think we were able to accomplish that.
Yeah, and usually I think in most cases you can say if you could accomplish it in that particular storm, you ought to be able to accomplish it in 4 or 5 inches of snow.
Absolutely.
Well, that's terrific. Do any of the businesses or can people help? Are there any tips or any thoughts that anybody who is either has a business there or works there can do to make things go smoother and faster?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I was actually impressed with how smooth and quick we were able to clean up the area, because we did get some cooperation from the businesses. They did their part. Their main issue or part is to clear out their entrance, and then we'll clear out. We're mainly responsible for the crosswalks and intersections, but for a large, like historic event like this snow event was, we wanted to do as much as we can for those merchants. So we did a little bit extra and cleared out a lot of the space that maybe normally a merchant might have had to clean up. But again, because it was such a historic storm, we wanted to help out as much as possible. But we also did see many other merchants out there on their own, shoveling their own spaces as well. So it was a team effort.
Yeah, I think that's, you know, kind of, if you think about your own neighborhood, your own people you know, it really did become more of a team effort for this kind of a storm than maybe a simple storm.
Yes.
But now, that's great for the winter.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm.
But it's spring is coming.
Absolutely.
Can't wait.
I think. When it comes, what do you like in the summertime? What is instead of shoveling snow? What do you do then?
Well, it's preparation first. We're going to make sure that all of our equipment is operable, because again, a quick story about the storm. Because it was so much work, we had to go actually buy another snowblower in the middle of the storm. One of our snowblowers went down. So again, so for the spring, we want to make sure that all of our equipment is ready to go. It's operating, and if it's not operating, get it in for service so that it's ready when we need it.
Right.
And it, like I said earlier, we have we have weed eaters. We'll be weed abatement, pressure washing, regular schedule for pressure washing. So we try to get the entire district pressure washed at some point, which includes the gum removal, that sort of thing. But the big issue is preparing for the spring, getting our equipment ready.
Okay, and then in the summertime, mostly it's just keeping things.
Yeah, in the summertime it's more of a maintenance. You know, we're just maintaining the daily routine of litter control, removing garbage, you know, the bags, the garbage bags. Let's see, graffiti removal, that sort of thing. In the summer, we're active into a lot of the events. There are some weeks where we have maybe three events in a week.
You know, and I perhaps should have asked you this when we were talking about the Fire and Ice Festival. Are there many, do you ever run into situations where you have to help people, especially I'm thinking emergencies?
Sure. Yeah, we had one at the Fire and Ice. We had to make an announcement over the intercom in the middle of acts. That a lady was missing, I think, three of her children.
Mm-hmm. Oh, right, right, yeah. I remember, yeah.
Yeah, so our team had to go out and try to find out, you know, try to locate them, and I was fortunate, I was on our Segway, so I was able to get around a lot faster, and so within a few minutes, I was able to locate, I think, the three kids and bring them back up to the podium, so where the mother was, and kind of...
Right, right, yeah. And so bring them back together.
Exactly.
But what, you know, during regular days, are there ever any of those, or evenings, are there any kind of situations where, and I hate to put it this way, but you find someone almost lying in the street and you have to, you know, get some emergency help?
It's actually funny, there's a gentleman downtown, unfortunately, he does that a lot. And I went 3 days in a row that I had to call the Reading Police Department so they would come out and assist and take care of him. It happens, not every night, but it does happen. At least we have the tools that we have, the Reading Police Department, which I'm grateful for, and of course the EMS services who come out and help.
And you have your, of course you have your eyes.
Absolutely.
You're watching around. Do you,
we have cell phones.
Do you patrol the whole area?
The whole area.
I'm thinking on just a regular day when there might be nothing going on.
Yeah.
Okay.
I was just going to say, a big part of what we do is actually a visual deterrent to crime. Mm-hmm. So just us being out there in the streets with a uniform, with a radio, with a cell phone, and the people in the area know who we are. So it's just being a visual deterrent is a big help.
Well, we mentioned earlier and about the vehicle escorts. Mm-hmm. Now, you'll do that anytime during the day or through the evening until...
11:30.
Until 11:30 at night.
Quickly, our hours of operation, Monday through Friday, 6:30 a.m. to 11:30 p.m. You can call any time during those times. And then on Saturday, we are in operation 10 a.m. to 6:30 p.m. off Sunday.
Okay. And the number to call, which is up on the screen right now, is 484-955-0315. And generally, how is there a time, like, should people call ahead of time and say, give you...
Give me like a 20-minute notice at least, but there's certain situations that you can't give a notice, so regardless, I'll drop what I'm doing and I'll stop
it. Okay, I'm just thinking that, you know, if you have two or three people, it's a, it's a little more of a situation. So, the Downtown Improvement District, how many, I should ask, how many ambassadors are there?
We have 12 on staff.
12?
Yes. Okay. And six normally on the day shift and two to three on the evening shift, depending on the day.
Okay, what about Saturday and Sunday?
Saturday you have three on the shift from 10 a.m. to 6:30 p.m. and Sunday where it is a non-operational day. We do have some events by exception that we post for, but generally it's an off day Sunday.
Okay, but basically any day Monday through Saturday, which is when people are going to tend to be in that that downtown area, the ambassadors are there. Look for the red. Look for the red shirts. The summer uniforms are the same?
Correct, the same uniform, yes. Short sleeves.
Short sleeves.
Yeah, we'll have shorts.
Shorts.
Yes. Baseball caps.
Okay, so, so you are dressed for the weather.
Sure.
That's a good thing. Well, this has been Downtown Alive. It's all about the Downtown Improvement District, which is in downtown Reading. My guests have been Shane Hillard, Ambassador's Manager, along with Chris Vazquez, who is the night shift supervisor of the Ambassadors. And look for them downtown. They help with all the big, big activities. And again, don't forget that the midday cafes will be coming up once the weather gets nice.
Correct.
And then, of course, the next Fire and Ice Festival next year, which put on your calendar, January 13th and 14th, 2017. All right, well, I'm Jack Molets, and we will be back next month with another program right here on BCTV, and it's called Downtown Alive, and it's all about your Reading Downtown Improvement District. Have a good day.